Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today as we wrap up our first Wisconsin Celebrates Pollinator Week. My name is Tim Ripp. I am a horticulture outreach specialist for Sauk County. And today I have with me Andrea Ackerman. She is a horticultural outreach specialist from Brown County. We will be your moderators for today. Please use the Q&A feature to ask your questions today. You should be able to find this at the bottom of your screen if you're on a laptop. If you're using a cell phone or tablet, you might need to tap the screen to bring the menu with the Q&A feature up. We will get to as many questions as we can at the end of the presentation today. We are not using the chat feature, so please do not put your questions in the chat. We're recording the webinar and link to the recording will be on the Extension Horticultural website after. It is now my pleasure to introduce Lynn Markham. Lynn is a UW Extension land use specialist based in Stevens Point. Lynn, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, Tim. I'm just getting organized here a second. All righty, how's that look?
Looks good.
Okay, great. Thank you to everybody for joining us today. Thanks to Tim, thanks to Andrea for organizing this webinar. I certainly appreciate this opportunity. So I think this is an exciting topic. I think pesticides and how they work are interesting. I think pollinators and songbirds, especially when they're right by your house, are amazing. And so this brings the two together. So in this webinar, we're going to take a look at the research studies and what they've found about how pesticides affect pollinators and songbirds. And then we'll check out examples of what people have done to help the pollinators and songbirds, both in their yards as well as across their communities. So here's our general outline. We'll talk a little bit about pollinators. If you've been on other webinars this week, I'm sure you've heard plenty about pollinators. Then we'll jump into pesticides, some background about the different types and what we know about their health effects. And then how do pesticides affect pollinators? We'll look at the research on that and then what we can do. So in Wisconsin, who are the pollinators? I'm sure bees are something that come to mind for most of you. We have a wide variety of bees. We have honeybees, which are not native, but we have many native bees as well. We have a wide variety of butterflies, moths, beetles, wasps, as well as the ruby-throated hummingbird. I've been seeing that hummingbird recently in my yard. It's wonderful. So why is it in my yard and what got me into this? It's that bottom right set of photos, the blueberries and the bumblebees. Probably 15 years ago, we planted 40 blueberry bushes in our yard, 20 in the front yard, 20 in the backyard. And we love blueberries. And we used to have a lot of bumblebees, and then the number went down. I don't exactly know why. And then I'll talk later in the presentation about some of the things that have led to the number coming back up. And now we see a lot of bumblebees in our yard, and we're seeing the ruby-throated hummingbird coming to the blueberry blossoms in our yard and getting nectar there. Okay, everything is connected. We need native plants in order to have insects, and we need insects in order to feed the birds, the fish, and the mammals. As you can see in the photos below, many of our birds, 96% of them, depend entirely on insect protein. Caterpillars are their favorites to feed their young. So even the birds that come to your feeders and eat seeds a good share of the year need caterpillars in order to feed their babies. The caterpillars are soft and squishy and easy to chew, easy to eat for very young birds. Also, if you like fish or fishing, I was surprised to learn that up to 40% of the protein that fish eat comes from insects. Insects that maybe start in the water as larvae, but then come out of the water, but then fall back into the water to feed the fish. So it's also important from that standpoint. Here's a long list of different woody plants and non-woody plants, the herbaceous plants. And the reason I'm putting these up is it shows, this is research by Doug Tallamy from University of Delaware, how many butterfly or moth species are supported by each species. So you can see oak, black cherry, and willow are kind of like the rock stars of the trees and shrubs in our area in terms of how many butterflies and moths they can support. And if you look at the non-woody plants, goldenrod, asters, sunflowers, Joe Pieweed, morning glory, also support a lot of butterflies and moths. So we need these plants there if we want our butterflies, our moths, our pollinators in general to be there. These are just a few books that I think are great. So if you have more interest in this book, in this topic, the right two are more reference books. The left one is a great story about a woman who realized that honeybees cannot pollinate tomato plants. It's wild bees that pollinate tomato plants. And so that got her thinking about what's happening to the wild bees and what can we do. A good read. If I have an R on something in my slides, that means that there's more information or a link to it on a reference sheet that I've provided to Extension. And they are going to post that on their website. They may also email it out to you. Okay, so we have all these bees and other pollinators. In Wisconsin, we have 500 wild bee species. All of them are pollinators. All of them are beneficial, and the bees have co-evolved with the flowers. When we have lots of different flowers in our yards and our parks, then we have lots of bees, and lots of bees can pollinate the flowers and lead to more seeds and more flowers. Insect pollinators need three things to survive. They need food, such as nectar and pollen. They need shelter, and we'll talk a little bit later about what they need for shelter, and they need protection from insecticides. Insecticides are designed to kill insects. The four P's of bee decline, and this comes from Marla Spivak. She's a professor who studies bees at the University of Minnesota. Honeybees and all of our bees are in decline, and this diagram is for honeybees because they've been studied the most. We think there are four things contributing to the bee decline. First, they're subject to a lot of pathogens and parasites, diseases and other things that can ruin their health. They run into a lot of pesticides, and in some places they have poor nutrition. That poor nutrition can be due to a lack of habitat, a lack of flowering native plants. There's a link to the video that Marla does on the reference sheet. Here's a list of our endangered, threatened, and special concern pollinators in Wisconsin. And I'm not going to go through each one, but I wanted to show a few of them. We've got two species of bumblebees, seven butterflies, and two moth species. And if we look at the photos from top to bottom, at the top is a rusty-patched bumblebee. You probably know the monarch that's next. The bluish butterfly is the Karner blue. It eats lupine. And then the fritillary down on the bottom. Insects, and particularly caterpillars that are easy for baby birds to eat, constitute a substantial part of the diet of many bird species during the breeding season, and they're indispensable for raising offspring. So a pair of chickadees, if you've ever watched them feeding young, they are busy, and they need to collect 350 to 570 caterpillars every day for their young. So this is why they're flying back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. I've got teenagers, but I think that baby chickadees maybe eat more than teenagers on a weight for weight basis. So that means it takes between 6,000 and 9,000 caterpillars to feed one clutch of babies to get them from the time they hatch until they fledge. These caterpillars only grow on native plants. They don't grow on bluegrass. They don't grow on ornamentals. So that's why we need native plants if we want insects and if we want songbirds in our yard. Unfortunately, this is what a lot of our urban residential areas look like, or suburban areas. And this isn't good habitat for pollinators or birds. It's not really good habitat for anything except maybe Canada geese. So the question is, how can we make areas that look like this more hospitable to pollinators? The pavement, anywhere you have pavement, the driveways, the sidewalks, there's no habitat there. No habitat for bees or other pollinators. And then the other thing we can't tell by looking at it is, would this yard harm the health of pollinators? Are there chemicals on it that could harm a pollinator? You can't really tell from looking. Sometimes there are signs up, sometimes not. So from a pollinator's perspective, this is a huge improvement. We can provide habitat by providing a diversity of plants that bloom throughout the season so that the pollinators always have healthy food to eat each day, good nutrition. And a study published this year in 2022 found that bumblebees are less susceptible to a common fungicide if they have a diverse food supply. So just like people, if they eat a good diversity of food, they're healthier than if they eat the same thing every day. Okay, so I'd like to talk about the effects of different types of pesticides. So a pesticide is any substance or mixture of substances that's intended for preventing, destroying, repelling, or mitigating any pest. There are more than 600 registered ingredients and 25,000 different products on the market. So there's lots out there. The first one shown here is an insecticide. This includes neonics, which I'll talk more about later. They're designed to kill insects. They can be harmful or fatal to bees and other beneficial insects. We also have fungicides. They control blight and other diseases. They may have detrimental effects on bee nutrition if they destroy the beneficial yeasts and microorganisms in bees' guts. It's just like people, we're learning that how happy our intestines are, how healthy they are, affects our overall health. And herbicides or weed killers or plant killers kill flowers in or around fields that provide nectar and pollen for bees. So just some of the ways that different pesticides impact bees and other pollinators. So this is a study about Roundup, an herbicide. It's kind of interesting. They found that bumblebees had 94% mortality when they were sprayed with one version of Roundup. But then the more interesting part is there's a type of Roundup that's called Roundup No Glyphosate. It doesn't have glyphosate in it, which is typically thought of as the active ingredient. And yet there was 96% mortality of bumblebees with this product. So this leads us to, it's probably not glyphosate that's killing the bumblebees. We think that the mortality is probably due to the surfactants, which are considered inert ingredients in Roundup. So surfactants are like soaps, and they can certainly impact insects. So after pesticides are sprayed, where do they go? Well, ideally, they would only harm the target pest, and then they would break down into things that are harmless. But that's not what we're finding. Obviously, when you spray pesticides on plants, and those plants are food for animals, they'll be eaten that way. The pesticides get into the insects, they get into the birds that eat the insects and other wildlife that eat the insects. Some pesticides bind to soil. So when you come in the house and you've got some dirt on your shoes, that dirt or soil may have pesticides in it that you brought into the house. We've learned over time that pesticides can drift for miles on the air. It depends on how windy it is and how much dust there is in the air that those pesticides can bind to. But on some days, the pesticides can move miles. People who apply pesticides are exposed to them, and some pesticides dissolve easily in water. And so then they move with the water through runoff into lakes and streams, or as the water infiltrates into the ground and gets into groundwater. So everything is connected. The pesticides are connected to the water, the soil, the plants, the insects, and everything that eats the insects. So the connections are there. I want to talk a little bit about how insecticide use has changed over time. So DDT use as an insecticide began in the 1940s and was used on crops and around homes and gardens for about 30 years. The number of bald eagles in North America declined greatly after World War II, due primarily to the eggshell thinning effects of DDT. After banning DDT in the US and Canada during the early 1970s, the number of bald eagles increased. Fast forward to the 1990s, and the main insecticides were organophosphates. In the 2000s, it changed to pyrethroids, and a bit later, neonicotinoids. As shown in the graph, neonicotinoid use increased greatly from 2000 on forward to 2015 is what the graph shows. So a question about any pesticide is, what effects does it have on non-target organisms, the organisms that you're not intending to harm? It often takes 10 to 20 years or more to fully answer that question. And in the meantime, manufacturers, pesticide manufacturers, seek approval of new pesticides each year because we do have resistance that's developing. Okay, this is an example from 2019. This article announces the EPA will allow the use of a pesticide considered very highly toxic to bees. The first sentence of the article reads, "The EPA approved broad new applications for a controversial insecticide, despite objections from environmental groups and beekeepers who say it is among the compounds responsible for eviscerating the nation's bee populations." So this pesticide is an insecticide called sulfoxaflor, and pesticides do lose their effectiveness over time as the pests develop resistance to them. Sometimes then people will apply higher levels of the pesticides or mixtures of pesticides to try to control the pests. And this is why pesticide manufacturers are developing new pesticides and trying to get them approved. Okay, let's talk a little bit about mosquitoes. Perhaps you've seen in your area many companies offering mosquito treatments for people's yards. And so what are the effects? It's typically pyrethroids are the class of insecticides used to kill mosquitoes, but pyrethroids are also known to kill fireflies, butterflies, and bees. The woman shown here on the slide is Karen Oberhauser. She spent over 30 years looking at monarchs. And her research found high mortality of monarch caterpillars after they were fed milkweed leaves that had been treated with a pyrethroid, like mosquito control, up to 3 weeks earlier. So even 3 weeks after pyrethroids are sprayed, they can kill the monarch caterpillars. Here's some pesticides commonly used for mosquito control in the US. So you can see organophosphates, pyrethroids, and the neonics here. And basically the overall message is that all of them are toxic, highly toxic to honeybees with direct exposure. This is a sign that was created and distributed in a city in Georgia, Decatur. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that correctly. And it's just making the point of what the research has shown, that when you use pyrethroids to kill mosquitoes, that you're also killing many other insects. So what are some other options for mosquito control? The first one is to remove standing water It takes 14 days for mosquito eggs to become adults. So they have to be in water for 14 days in order to mature. So you have 14 days to get rid of the water so that you don't end up with a bunch of mosquitoes. And as you know, sometimes this is possible, sometimes it's not. But for most of us, there are things we can do to control it. So I think that the, you know, all the containers sitting around your yard, to me, were fairly obvious, you know, to look for those sorts of standing water. One that I'm totally guilty of, though, I found was clogged gutters. It doesn't actually show a gutter here, but you know what a gutter looks like. And next to our gutter on one side is a number of trees, cedar trees that drop some of their cedar stuff into here, and it clogs up the gutter. Okay, but that means there's standing water all along here. So it's something to check on a regular basis. I've learned that in my yard, you don't want to let it go for more than a month before you've got enough there to block water again. Other options are outdoor fans and screen porches. Mosquitoes are not strong flyers, so the fans will keep them from flying and landing on you. Obviously, screen porches are also helpful. Long sleeves and pants when working in the yard, or my preferred method is choose a cool morning when it's still cool enough that nobody's flying too much, at least if we've got cool mornings. And then one other option is mosquito dunks or mosquito bits. These are a type of bacteria, Bacillus thuringiensis, Israelensis. I'm not sure I'm pronouncing that last part right. But you place the dunk in standing water and it kills mosquito larvae. And at this point, we think it's fairly specific to just mosquito larvae. So let's look a little bit more at the neonics and the toxicity of the different classes of chemicals. So what I did here is I went to the National Pesticide Information Center at Oregon State and looked at what they said about each class of pesticides. So the organophosphates that became popular in the 1990s are known to be very toxic to bees, aquatic insects, fish, and many bird species. The pyrethroids are highly toxic to bees and fish. This is the mosquito spraying type of insecticide. And then the neonics, the more recent ones, and we still have pyrethroids around as well as some of the organophosphates. But the neonics are very toxic to bees, other beneficial insects, and some aquatic insects. So all of these insecticides, probably not too surprisingly, are hard on some of the insects that we care about. If we look at pesticide toxicity trends and what's been happening over time, as shown here on the left in panel D, this is true for birds as well as mammals. The direct toxicity of pesticides applied in the U.S. has decreased from 1993 to 2015 for birds and mammals. On the flip side, if we look at the total applied toxicity of pesticides for pollinators and aquatic invertebrates, it's more than doubled from 2005 to 2015. So as the pyrethroids came into common use, they were much more toxic for aquatic invertebrates. As the neonics came into common use, they were much more toxic for pollinators. So this is the shift that we've seen over time. If we look at neonics in the news, they're implicated in colony collapse disorder in honeybees, one of many factors. In 2006, the worker bees abruptly disappeared. There's also a risk to other pollinators, bumblebees, native bees, butterflies. So another insect that we're seeing large declines in that's linked to birds is mayflies. Mayfly populations in the upper Mississippi basin dropped in half, 52% from 2012 to 2019. So why did this happen? We know that neonic pesticide levels are rising and mayflies are very sensitive to them. Other possible reasons are fertilizers. As we have more fertilizer getting washed into the water, this causes dead zones, areas where there's no oxygen. And mayfly in the nymph stage, they're down on the bottom. So if they can't get any oxygen down on the bottom, that can kill them. Also, our water temperatures are warming, and so there are possible decreasing circulation of oxygen in the lakes due to that. Mayflies are prey for fish, birds, and mammals. The abundance of flying insects has been linked to fledgling success in insect-eating birds. And the annual mayfly emergence in the Western Lake Erie Basin can support the energy demands of over 53 million nestling birds from hatching to fledging. So that's how important mayflies are to young birds, to birds reproducing. What we've got here is a male tree swallow arriving at the nest to feed its young with a mouthful of mayflies. Okay, let's talk about neonics and songbirds. Has residential neonic use impacted songbirds? I think it's hard to say in terms of the toxicity. We just don't have the studies yet to say whether it is impacting them or not. But if our neonic use is killing the insects, then birds have less food. They have fewer insects to eat. So it could certainly be impacting songbirds that way. We do see a clear trend. The higher concentrations of imidacloprid, which is one of the neonics, in lakes and streams, the greater the decline in insects and the greater the decline in bird numbers. Insects constitute a substantial part of the diet of many bird species, especially during the breeding season and raising offspring. This study looks at change in birds from 2008 to 2014. It was published in 2020. It found that bird biodiversity is declining in the US. The overall bird population decreased by 29% since 1970. Grassland birds declined by 53%. The authors from the University of Illinois found robust evidence of the negative impact of neonics, in particular on grassland birds like the eastern meadowlark shown here, and to some extent on insectivore birds overall, after controlling for the changes in land use. This map shows the change in grassland bird population due to neonic use from 2008 to 2014. The orange and red colors show declines, while blue colors show increases. And here's a zoomed in version of Wisconsin. So you can see that, unfortunately, we've got a lot of orange and red here. We do have at least one green county, but we're seeing grassland bird declines across most of Wisconsin. Okay, so what can we do? What are our options to protect pollinators and birds? I'm gonna start with some national policies. In 2013, Europe banned neonic use on flowering crops like canola to protect their pollinators. In 2018, they banned outdoor neonic use on all crops. It's still allowed in greenhouses, but not outside. In 2019, Canada canceled uses of imidacloprid on a number of crops. And in the US, we have had a Saving America's Pollinator Act introduced every 2 years for at least 10 years to ban neonics, but it has not passed. Other options are educational. You know, require pesticide labels to include information about impact to pollinators, including online retailers, that they put the information out there about the toxicity to pollinators. I'm going to show you an example in a little bit of a common lawn pesticide, and the information just isn't on the label about how it affects pollinators. We do have a number of garden retailers that have taken steps to protect pollinators. There was a study published in 2014 that found neonics on garden plants at many stores. In the next 5 years after that, we had 140 retail companies commit to getting rid of neonics in their products. And one question that I run into is, okay, some of the larger chains are making commitments and moving forward on this. What are locally owned stores doing? Maybe they're doing the same thing, maybe they're not. The only way to find out is ask. Also food retailers, neonics are used on food that's grown for human consumption. So there's a pollinator scorecard out there that includes the largest 25 grocery stores, grocery store chains. And based on the pesticides, their organic offerings, organic food offerings, and pollinator health, they're each given a grade. So you can see the grades range greatly. And if you want to know more about that, the website is right here in terms of how they handed out those grades. There's points for a number of different things. State policies. So we have a number of states that have taken action. What the majority who have acted have done is they've said, we know neonics are important for certain agricultural crops, but they're not necessary for people's yards and aesthetics. So these states, Maryland, Vermont, Massachusetts, and Maine, have said consumers are not allowed to buy pesticides like in the hardware store or grocery store containing neonics. Farmers and certified pesticide applicators are still permitted to apply neonics. In 2021, New York took a different approach. They banned the use of pesticides by school districts. They said, we don't want to be exposing kids to this, so we won't have school districts using neonics. In 2015, in Wisconsin, 60% of our honeybees were lost. And there have been a number of bills that have been introduced over the years in Wisconsin. The most recent was in 2021. The legislature proposed two bills to protect pollinators. One was to allow local governments to regulate pesticides to protect pollinators. And the second was to make sure that plants containing certain pesticides can't be labeled as pollinator friendly, trying to make sure that the education was accurate in marketing and labeling. These bills did not pass last year or in this last session. Community policies to protect pollinators. These cities have banned neonic use on city property, places like parks and other city property where City Hall is. And then we've got this group of kids in kindergarten. They started to learn about pesticides. And the impacts of pesticides. So one kindergarten class eventually became third graders. They initially educated the other kids at their school and their teachers. This is a picture of them in third grade going to City Hall to lobby for a ban on pesticides. And this is them in the New York Times. New York City eventually, when they were in seventh grade, agreed and banned pesticides from parks due to the push from this class. We also have other cities that have banned pesticides. Baltimore banned a narrower list of pesticides. And last year, Chicago, through a voluntary program, has stopped using chemical weed killers in 90% of its parks. When asked what's the secret to going to chemical-free lawn care, the city of Chicago said it's pretty simple. It's mow high. You want the grass to stay healthy. You want it to shade out weeds that might be starting. So they recommended mowing 3 inches or higher in order to keep healthy lawn without the chemicals. In the city of Eau Claire last year, they have a park where they've stopped using synthetic pesticides as well. I also know of other cities in Wisconsin that have simply chosen not to use pesticides in their parks. They may not have a policy for it, but if that's what the park director decides, sometimes that flies. We also have NOMO May. This is something that started in Appleton, Wisconsin. It's a voluntary program where people can mow less or they can mow not at all in the month of May. So it started in Appleton in 2020 with 435 households participating. And they did a study there and found that the lawns that were doing NOMO May, they had 5 times greater bee abundance and 3 times greater bee diversity than the mowed areas. This program has taken off across Wisconsin, and 2 years later, we had at least 23 communities that adopted NOMO May. Maybe you recognize some of them on the list. Helping pollinators in your yard. So what can you do? You want to help them throughout the season. And I'm one of those people in the winter that I get sucked into the garden catalogs, lots of different garden catalogs, including the native plant garden catalogs. And this is just one example I saw in one of the catalogs. Many of the native plant nurseries, and we do have many native plant nurseries around Wisconsin, will sell pollinator gardens for shady places or sunny places or sandy soils or heavier soils. So these are all things to consider, kind of fun to plant. Beyond prairie plants, here's something I've started thinking about. So I want bumblebees to come to my yard. I want to have a healthy bumblebee population. I know that many bumblebees, maybe all bumblebees, are solitary and they nest in the ground. And so I want them to find lots to eat early in the year, preferably before my blueberry bushes start blooming. So they're already there. So I've looked into early season perennials that will supply both nectar and pollen. Pussy willows are one option. Plum trees are another option. Service berry trees, these get little blue berries on them. Some people say they taste like blueberries. I don't really think so. But we get lots of service berries in our yard, and mostly they're bird food. But the birds seem to really enjoy them. And then blueberries and other shrubs. Basically all these plants, shrubs and trees, they already have that established root system. So they can feed the nutrients up to form the blossoms early in the year. They don't have to develop a root system and a stem and all that first. So they can provide pollen and nectar earlier in the year. Helping pollinators in your yard. One suggestion is to be messy, at least in certain parts of your yard. And the reason is 70% of native bees are ground bees. So they need a place where they can get into the ground. They may need some cover. So leaving a few leaf piles or maybe a compost heap, a few spots of tall grass in your yard, native plants, or some areas of undisturbed soil. For spring nests, as well as for the bees to overwinter in. And there is a very fun kids book that covers this. It's a queen bee going on a scavenger hunt in order to find a good place to nest. Dead trees are also very helpful. And that book is Begin with a Bee. So this is the queen bee that goes on a scavenger hunt to find everything she needs to build her colony. It was written in Minnesota, by the way. Also helping pollinators in your yard. So you might see a chewed leaf like this and say, we have insect problems. Or you might see, this is milkweed, and when I see a chewed area on the leaf, I flip over the leaf and I look for a caterpillar because my daughter loves to raise monarch caterpillars. And it means that these plants are supporting monarch caterpillars, butterflies, moths, fireflies, they all need plant matter to eat. And so when we see that they've eaten some plants, that can be a good thing. It's just how we frame it in our minds. So there's the monarch caterpillar. This is an oak tree, and you can see the insects have been eating it as well. Remember that oak trees support over 500 species of butterflies and moths. So again, some chewing can be a good thing. It's not going to, you know, at this level, it's not going to harm the tree. It's just feeding some insects. So coming around to accepting some chewing on our plants, that it can actually be viewed as a positive thing, that we're feeding the insects that we want to feed. I think it's also important that if you're considering using a pesticide, that you learn to read pesticide labels. So first, you need to identify the pest. And quite honestly, Andrea and Tim are going to be way better in helping you identify the pest. In the store, my experience is a lot of the labels, you now need to peel them off the bottle in order to see the back side of the label. So don't think that what you're looking at initially is the whole label. You probably also want to bring your magnifying glass because some of the print can get awfully small. Online, sometimes if you look at pesticides online, trying to maybe do your homework ahead of time, the label may not be listed for the online retailer. I find I have better luck when I go to the manufacturer's website to look for a full label to get the information about that pesticide. There's a very nice video by Wisconsin Extension about how to read a pesticide label. I suggest starting at about 10 minutes. It talks about target pests, active ingredients, and the hazard level, and how to read that for each type of pesticide. And this is the link. I think you guys will get a recording or a link to this, to the slides afterward. And I just wanted to provide an example. So I'm not endorsing this product. I'm just using it as an example. So this is Scott's Turf Builder. It's a Summer Guard lawn food. And down underneath lawn food, it also says with insect control. Anytime you're looking at some sort of pesticide that says with insect control or something similar to that, it probably means it includes an insecticide. So in this case, the active ingredient is bifenthrin. I went to the Scott's website to pull down the label, and this is part of what it says. This pesticide is extremely toxic to fish and aquatic invertebrates. So that would be aquatic insects that birds and fish are going to eat. And it says nothing about pollinators. My understanding is it's not required to say anything legally. And my background says, where can I look this up? So here are a couple of options, places where I look. The National Pesticide Information Center has information about a wide range of pesticides. So when I look up bifenthrin there, it says bifenthrin is low in toxicity to birds. There are potential risks for birds and mammals that eat aquatic organisms because bifenthrin can last a long time in the environment and it may accumulate in fish. And then it says bifenthrin is highly toxic to fish and small aquatic organisms. It's also very highly toxic to bees. So it's good to know this before you choose a product to apply to your lawn. Another source is the Massachusetts Extension list of pesticides that are and their toxicity to pollinators and beneficials. So when I look up bifenthrin there, it's in the part of the sheet that says extremely to highly toxic to honeybees. Do not apply on blooming crops or weeds. So these are just a couple of resources to learn more about how different pesticides affect pollinators. Another thing is how you can help pollinators in your yard is to just try to relax a little bit. To be okay with some of the leaves being eaten, to try to minimize the use of pesticides, weed and feed. Those are the products that have both fertilizer and pesticide in them, and minimize neonic treated plants that you might get at the nursery. One thing that I've gotten into in the last couple of years is getting to know the pollinators, and I'm not too geeky about it. I don't know them by species, but I've had a lot of fun with this app. It's called the Weebee app. It's easy to find online. They have a couple little videos teaching you how to use it. It took maybe a half an hour for me to get up to speed after watching the videos and doing a couple quizzes. And you just sort the bees that you see into six different groups, large dark bees, bumblebees, small dark bees. It's pretty straightforward. And it's fun to learn, you know, where are they hanging out? What types are you finding? This was originally developed for farmers to find out if there were sufficient pollinators to pollinate their crops, to pollinate the crops that depend on pollinators, that don't produce fruit without it. So cranberries, apples, squash, melons, tomatoes, all of those crops. But it's also a lot of fun for people like me who aren't farmers, but want to know what pollinators are out there. Okay, we talked earlier about natural options for mosquito control. So in the end, what the pollinators need is lots of good, clean pollinator food for our pollinators and for the people who like to eat all these foods shown below that depend on pollinators. You can help birds in your yard by providing the insects, providing the native plants that the insects need to eat so that the birds can successfully raise their young. You can also help the birds by being okay with some cavities created by the pileated woodpeckers here. They're amazing excavators. And the holes that they excavate looking for termites and ants and other insects become the homes of bluebirds and other birds, as well as small owls like the saw-whet. I think it really comes down to what's important to you. I'll fess up, this is my daughter, so I'm a little attached to some of this. You know, is what's important to you enjoying butterflies, fireflies, and other insects? Is it sharing these experiences with young people in your lives? These are actually some photos that my daughter Tessa took in our yard. I'm thrilled that she's getting into going out with the camera and seeing what she can find in terms of bumblebees and butterflies and moths in our yard. Or is your goal to have no or few insects in your yard? You know, I think those questions really kind of help you make your choices of what you're gonna do. That's Tess with a monarch that she raised. So in the end, everything is connected. When you exterminate the bugs, you're actually exterminating the birds too, because they need those insects in order to survive themselves and to feed their young. So I think I will wrap it up there, and I'm happy to take any comments or questions.
Awesome, Lynn. Thank you so much for joining us today and during Pollinator Week, especially, just to bring awareness to the pollinators, our local pollinators and their habitats. And before we get to the questions, we would appreciate you folks joining us today to take a few minutes to provide us your feedback about the program today and using the quick link in the chat. And I do want to say one more thing. Thank you for bringing up the information about the Weebie app. So Claudio was on our program earlier this week. So if you're interested in learning more about the Weebie app, you can find that on our website. We will be posting all of the video recordings from the week on our website. So feel free to find it there. And with that, Tim, I'll turn it over to you to start with the questions.
All right. Yes. Thank you, Lynn. That was a wonderful presentation. Really appreciate that. So we'll start with our first question here. Will BT used to control caterpillars on my roses not reduce butterflies in the garden? Because I'm not sure what BT refers to. Maybe you know.
I'm thinking BTI. No. I'm not 100% sure. There is another. Yeah, there's BT that's bred into corn, I know. But I don't think I can answer this question.
Maybe we'll skip that one for now. Yeah. Maybe we can get a little more feedback on that one. We'll move to the next one. We have not and do not use herbicides or pesticides in our yard, but our neighbors have and do. Could their herbicide or pesticide use impact our soil, plants, wildlife, pets, and humans via runoff, aerialization, or other ways?
Yeah, this is a tricky topic. The answer to your first part is, could they be impacting your yard? Definitely, they could. So one thing I didn't mention is when pesticides are applied on, say, a cool day or a cool portion of the day, you know, they may stay wherever you put them. But when it heats up, then some pesticides, depending on their physical properties, they are going to evaporate on hot days, and they are going to move. And wherever they settle when it cools down again is where they settle. So yes, pesticides can move that way. Pesticides can also move through runoff. You know, it gets washed off during a rain. And if you're downhill from one of your neighbor's yards, it could be running into your yard. I would guess also, you know, if you've got a windy day and you can see the dust in the air, that could be coming from your neighbor's yard and whatever they're using as well. So yeah, those things can impact what's going on in your yard. I've thought for a number of years about having like a little handout and going around to neighbors. In my neighborhood, there's not a lot of spraying going on, but there are a few neighbors that have Chem Lawn or some other similar company. Just to let people know, I don't feel like it's my job to tell them what to do, but I would like to make sure that they're informed about what the potential impacts are of choices.
Hey, thanks, Lynn. Tim, I just have a follow-up on the BT question. So there are many different types of BT out there, and I think the one that the question is referring to is probably more towards the caterpillar and lepidopteran target, or the active ingredient is for the caterpillars. So I would just make sure you're reading the labels when you go to use a BT. They're definitely very specific. So the one that Lynn mentioned would be, and I cannot say it correctly, but the Israelensis or some BTI, that one is directed for mosquitoes. That is the targeted for mosquitoes. So I think hopefully that clears up the question in regards to BT. And then the next question we'll go to Lynn is, any concern about citronella lamps used in the garden to reduce mosquitoes?
The only thing I've read about that is that it's not always very effective. I don't know if it has impacts on other insects. Yeah, I couldn't say for sure on that. But I've heard that it's not the most effective, and maybe different people have different experiences with it. To me, it might be more straightforward to just put out a fan, you know, if you're in not a huge area, to keep the mosquitoes away.
All right, next question would be, this concerns an apartment container garden. My neighbors and I all have problems with the large numbers of fungus gnats. I've found water mixed with a bit of neem oil and a tiny amount of soap to be effective. Is it safe for pollinators? Is it safe for me on the foods that I eat from the garden? Would putting dunks in non-edible plants help? What else could I do to control fungus gnats?
Okay. I am not an expert on this. I will say that when you use soaps, you know, insects that come directly in contact with it can be impacted, but it's not likely to move, you know, any significant distance. I don't know about neem oil and whether it's safe for pollinators. I can say that not all plant oils are safe for pollinators. Pyrethrins, one of the classes of insecticide, are concentrated versions of liquid from chrysanthemums. So concentrated plant oils can harm insects. I'm not saying all do, but some do. So that's something to keep in mind. Andrea, Tim, do you want to jump in on if you know anything about neem oil?
Not specific to neem oil, but oftentimes I think we see fungus gnats emerging when there's a lot of moisture. So oftentimes cultural controls, just reducing your watering and making sure your plants actually need the water, and understanding, you know, what your inputs are, can help with a lot of that. And then making sure if you're using the same containers, if it's a container garden, which is what I think I read, that you are, you know, changing the soil out over the several seasons and making sure that you're just creating a healthy environment for those plants as well. Tim, you got anything else to add?
No, that's what I would add for that. Just keeping those soils, you know, aerated very well. With the dunks, I do have experience with those, that they are not harmful to ducks. I used to use them in my duck pond. So they do a good job of reducing mosquito larvae. And as far as I can tell from my own personal use, they had no effects on my ducks. So that was great.
Awesome. The next question here, I'll read it to you. We might be able to answer this on another platform, but it says, does milky spore attack all beetles, not just Japanese beetles, and does it also kill other insects? Not sure if you are familiar with the milky spore, Lynn.
I know it for Japanese beetles, but I don't know about what else it impacts.
Sounds good. We'll put that one to the side, and I will drop an answer in the Q&A section. Great. All right, Tim.
Okay. So here's another question. So often lawn care companies that spray herbicides provide, if not four or five or more treatments, according to UW Turf Management, one or two treatments at most have been stated in past seasons. So freshening is not more control, such companies. Oh, I'm sorry, that it's more of a statement. I'm sorry about that. Let's find another one here. How about this one? This is, in your experience, what has been learned about, effects of some of these pest controls with pets, sort of dogs, cats, as far as lawn care treatments and chemicals and those things?
Right. It's going to depend on which chemical is used. I would point you to the same, here I can back up to it, these two same sources, you know, looking up the chemical that's being used in lawn care. I do know I've read at least one study about dogs that one of the lawn pesticides that's used has negative impacts on dogs. I believe it was a type of cancer that they saw more of in dogs that spent time on treated lawns. I can dig up that study if you want to email me. I'd be happy to send you that. But I think the best approach is, you know, to look up the specific chemical that's in the product that you're considering or a contractor is looking at using on your yard. Now, get back to my, whoops.
And then I think there's several comments and maybe questions that talk about public health in regards to, you know, mosquitoes and insects that have illnesses or are vectors for illness. And maybe this is more of a discussion, Lynn, but I think maybe our point here today is having the conversations about the effects of how pesticides do affect our pollinators and just our ecosystems in general. And it's, you know, maybe there's some instances where folks feel that's their only option, but really just understanding what you are applying and how it affects the ecosystem around you. I mean, I'm not sure what your take is on that in terms of public health, but just a thought.
I agree with you, Andrea. I think the best place to start is the pesticide label. You know, I think a lot of people just grab something that they've used before or something that somebody else recommended. And I've answered a lot of questions along those lines from friends and neighbors. You know, what about this pesticide? What about that pesticide? And that's where I always start is, well, let's look at the label and what it says. Are you okay with what it says here? And then, like I said, specific to pollinators, dig farther because they're not required to say on the label what the impacts are. regarding human health, there can be impacts there too. I've certainly looked at that and looked at that yesterday for neonics. There are two reviews out there about the impacts of neonics on human health and other animal health. I'm happy to provide those if people are interested in looking at those. I guess I always think the starting place is, you know, learn as much as you can, but also recognize that not every study has been done. So there may be some unknown effects as well when you're applying it, especially if you're thinking about applying it to food crops or something that your kids or your pets are going to spend time on. Yeah. I guess that's one other thing I can add is, from all the pesticide studies I've looked at, it's the youngest, you know, animal or insect or whatever in the youngest form is when they tend to be most susceptible to the impacts, because they're still changing, they're still growing. You know, if I put pesticide on my little finger, it's going to affect, at least in the short term, just my little finger. But if it's one cell of an organism that's growing to be 100,000 cells, that one cell, you know, within a month may be thousands of cells. So keeping that in mind, that it's particularly the developing organisms that are most susceptible to the effects of pesticides.
Right. And I think we also don't want to be counterintuitive, right? So if we're encouraging pollinators to come to our yards and with prairie gardens and, you know, planting specifically for pollinators, and then they were counteracting it with pesticide applications, I mean, we're not really doing them a service or helping them to do their thing and work for us. So just some stuff to think about. And with that, we do have 1 o'clock here, so we will wrap up today. Again, this will be posted on the website. And Lynn, thank you so much for sharing with us today. And we are so happy that you were able to be here.
Thank you, Lynn, for hosting. Thank you everyone for coming.
All right. Have a good weekend. Happy Pollinator Week.
Thank you.
Bye now.